Welcome back. In part two, we calculated that it would take about 1.7 ounce inches of torque to move 110 pound weight on this linear slide. When we did that, did we take into account real world issues like friction and other things that might cause additional drag on our system? No. In that equation we used, we zeroed all those terms out, right? How much difference do you think that made? Well, let's try it and find out. This is the exact slide we used in those calculations. I removed the motor and coupler and added a 2-inch nylon disc so we have a 1-inch radius. According to our calculations, at a 1-inch radius, we should need 1.7 ounces to move the carriage, right? I have a 2-ounce lead weight here. That should be more than enough. Not moving. Not even close. Okay, let's add some more lead weights. Nope. How about a little more weight? There we go. Now it wants to move. So it took about 4 ounces to get it to move easily once we got past the initial stiction. That's that extra little force required to get it moving. And remember, this is just a slide. What if we add the 110 pounds of normal load we used in the calculations? Well, let's add some more lead weights. No. Add a little more weight. Nope. Add a little more weight. There we go. That was around 12 ounces. So our calculated number was off by 700%. It's pretty impressive that we only need a few ounces to move this 110 pound load, but why is it so much different than the number we calculated? Well, the bottom line is, the calculated numbers don't take into account the real world. For example, the drag of the carriage is adjustable using these set screws. You can loosen them to reduce the friction and drag, but then things get looser and you lose accuracy. For some systems, that's fine. For others that need precision motion, these screws will have to be tighter, which will create more drag. How well the rails and screw are lubricated can make a difference. How tight the screw nuts are can make a difference. How long the slide has been in operation makes a difference. It's going to be a lot easier to move once it's broken in, right? And of course, this is an extreme example where just a few ounces are moving 110 pounds. So while we were off by 700%, remember that it really was just a few ounces. On larger machines where you aren't dealing with such small numbers, you'll find the calculations won't be off by such a large percentage. So there's lots of items here that are complicating things, and there's no way we could take them all into account because they all depend heavily on how the system is set up and maintained. That's why it's so important to understand that the calculated numbers are just a starting point to help you get in the ballpark. No one knows your system better than you do, so you're the only one that can decide how close those numbers may or may not be. All is not lost, though. Remember, when we compared those numbers to the torque chart, we found that this motor should easily move the load, right? Even if we were off by an order of magnitude, we should still have a great chance of this working. So let's prove it. I set up a Productivity 2000 controller to tell the motor to implement a profile identical to the one we used in the calculations, except I lengthened the travel to 3 inches so it'd be easier for us to see in the video. And I did it in both directions so it can run continuously back and forth. I then filled up this 5-gallon bucket full of dense marble stone and then put some dumbbells on top of that to get us to the 110 pounds we need. Now it's just teetering there, but hopefully it's stable enough for our little proof of concept. Well, let's try it. Enable the PLC, and look at that. This little motor has no issues moving this 110 pound load. Awesome. In fact, I actually leaned on this weight, adding maybe another 30 or 40 pounds, and the system still had no problem. No missteps or anything. So it looks like we have plenty of margin, which again, our calculations and curves implied from the beginning. Well, if nothing else, hopefully you can see why making sure you have plenty of margin after doing your calculations is so important. You just never know what the real world's going to throw at you. By the way, there's absolutely nothing wrong with setting up an experiment like this to simply measure the torque you need. Or on larger systems, just use a torque wrench to measure the torque required. But remember, even with that real measured number, we still suggest that you leave at least 50% margin. Again, you never know what the real world's going to throw at you. And one more thing to be aware of, inertia mismatch. In a perfect world, you want to match your motor's rotor inertia to the system inertia. That'll give you the absolute best possible motor performance. But in practice, if you can keep it within a 1-3 or 1-5 range, you'll be in pretty good shape. How do we do with our system? Well, our motor inertia is this, and the system inertia that the motor sees, we call that the inertia reflected back to the motor, is this. That's a 37-1 ratio, which just means that while the motor is perfectly capable of moving this load, it won't be able to get anywhere near close to performing as well as what the curves show. Which if that's all you need, then no problem. But if you do need that performance, is there anything you can do about it? Sure, you can get a bigger motor, or you can insert a gearbox or belt and pulley or anything that implements a gear ratio of some kind. Why? Well, remember from our equations, the inertia reflected back to the motor is modified inversely by the square of the gear ratio. So by adding some kind of gear reduction, you can drastically change the inertia the motor sees. For example, if we take our system, but add in a 3-to-1 gearbox or a belt and pulley system, the inertia behind the gearbox gets divided by 9, which brings it down to an acceptable mismatch level that will allow the motor to perform. Of course, you still have to add in the inertia of the gearbox. That's why we call it reflected inertia. It's the modified inertia sent to, or reflected to, the motor after gearing. So the bottom line is, you really need two things to determine how well your stepper motor will perform. Does it have plenty of margin on the torque curves, and does it have a decent inertia mismatch? If you need any help with selecting an Automation Direct stepper motor, please contact Automation Direct's free, award-winning support team during regular business hours. They'll be happy to help. And don't forget the forums. There are lots of folks there that love to share their years of experience. Just don't post any questions directed at Automation Direct support staff there. They don't monitor the forums on a regular basis.